Can you see the screen now?
Yes, sir, the screen is visible.
So today we are going to start with the topic on fluid mechanics, and it's a sort of brief introduction to fluid mechanics, not much in detail. I think this much you might be knowing earlier also, and you must have studied this in your 11th class course also. So what is fluid mechanics? Fluid mechanics is that branch of science which deals with the behavior of fluids. So when we say fluids, it is either liquids or gases, okay? So fluid mechanics is dealing with the behavior of fluids which are either at rest or at motion, okay? So this branch of science deals with static, kinematics and dynamic aspects of the fluids. The study of the fluids at rest is called fluid statics. The study of the fluids in motion, where the pressure forces are not considered, is called kinematics. When we talk about the kinematics, we are concerned with the velocity, acceleration and so on, but we are not concerned about the forces which are causing the fluid to flow. Actually, we are just interested in calculation of their velocities and acceleration. If the pressure forces are also considered for fluids in motion, that branch of science is called fluid dynamics. So we are going to study a little bit about I think somebody's mic is on, so please mute yourself. Now, properties of fluid. The first one is the density or the mass density. Density, you already know. Only thing is that we have given it another name, which is mass density. So you know that density represented by rho is actually equal to m divided by v. So here in fluid mechanics, we will call it as the density or mass density to differentiate it from the weight density. Okay, so in mass density, we are writing mass per unit volume. You know the unit is kg per meter cube, and when we calculate the mass density or the density of the water, it is 1000 kg per meter cube. So this is mass density. Similarly, we can talk about the weight density. It is represented by small w, and that is equal to the weight of the substance divided by the volume. So it can be represented as mg divided by v. And if you remember exactly, then the unit of weight is newton and that of volume is meter cube. So weight density is small w and its unit is newton per meter cube. So it's written here. It is also known as specific weight or weight density. So weight density is small w given by weight of the fluid divided by the volume of the fluid. Okay, so small w, it is because mass per unit volume is density, so it is written as rho multiplied by g. So small w is equal to rho g. So small w is nothing but it is either known as basic specific weight or weight density. And you know, if we want to calculate the specific weight for the water, because the value of g is 9.81 and the density value is 1000, so weight density for water is 9.81 into 1000 newton per meter cube. So always write newton as only capital N, meter cube as like this. So this is the SI unit of specific weight or the weight density. Then you know already about the specific volume. Specific volume, small v is mass, volume per unit mass. So units are meter cubes per kg, and it is also equal to 1 by rho. So small v is equal to 1 by rho, which is equal to v by m. So this is already known to you. We studied it in the basic mechanical engineering first or second lecture also. Then yes, this is the important property. Specific gravity, we denote it as capital S. So we define this for liquids, we define it for gases. Okay, when we define it for liquids, we say it is the weight density of the liquid, or sometimes we can also call it as the density of the liquid divided by the weight density of the water, or say density of the water. So if I am defining the specific gravity of a liquid, then I will write it as, let us say, rho for the liquid divided by the density for the water, or I can also write it as w for the liquid divided by the specific weight of the water. And if you see it carefully, then this specific weight of the liquid will be equal to density of the liquid into g, and this is density of the water multiplied by g. So effectively you can find out that specific gravity s is equal to wl divided by ww, or density of the liquid divided by density of the water. So when I have to define the specific gravity for the gases, okay, so the denominator part we change it to weight density, or the density of the air, and in the numerator we take weight density of the gas. So it can be written as, that means if I am defining it for gases, I will put a symbol g for gases. That will be equal to density of that particular gas divided by the density of air, or we can also call it as the weight density of the gas divided by the weight density of the air. So this was about the specific gravity. Now you see this formula is quite easy to remember, and if we want to calculate the weight density of the liquid, okay, then it's quite easy. I can multiply s by weight density of the water. So weight density of the liquid, means w for the liquid, will be equal to s, which is the specific gravity, and the weight density of the water is 1000 into 9.81, this much newton per meter cube, because we are calculating the weight density, and weight density has the units newton per meter cube. Similarly, if I have to calculate the density for the liquid, then I will multiply the specific gravity by the density of the water. So it is nothing but the mass density. So mass density, if I am multiplying the specific gravity by the mass density of the water, then I will be getting the density of the liquid, or the mass density of the liquid. And if I am multiplying by the weight density of the liquid, then means if I am calculating the weight density of the liquid, then I will have to multiply by the weight density of the water. So let us if the specific gravity of a fluid is known, then the density of the fluid will be equal to the specific gravity of the fluid multiplied by the density of the water. For example, the specific gravity of the mercury is 13.6. so the meaning of 13.6 is that it is 13.6 times heavier in comparison to water. So if I am taking a column of 1 meter of water, okay, if I am taking a column of 1 meter of water, if I say that this is 1 meter column of water, then for mercury, the column length which is producing the same weight or same density will be 1/13.6 meters. Okay, so that is why we say that the mercury is 13.6 times heavier in comparison to water, and its density will be 13,600 kgs per meter cube. I hope this is clear. Now there is a numerical problem, simple numerical problem. It says that calculate specific weight, that means small w, which is equal to rho into g, is to be calculated, density is to be calculated, specific gravity is to be calculated, and this is the volume of the liquid which is given to us. It is 1 liter, and you should always remember that 1000 liters, just a minute, you should always remember the conversion, that 1 meter cube means I am considering a pit, which is you can say, if this is a pit, okay, which is having a length 1 meter, here you have the width 1 meter and a depth of 1 meter, so its volume becomes 1 meter cube, and it contains 1000 liters of water. So you can easily convert from this relationship. It's easier way to remember. So 1 liter will be equal to 10^-3 meter cube, and if I want to calculate it in centimeter cubes, the value will come out to be 10^3 centimeter cubes. Okay, so you can see it here, volume is equal to 1 liter, which is equal to 1/1000 meter cube. So we have calculated the volume in SI units, then this is the weight, which is already given to us. So weight, now what is weight equal to? Weight is equal to W is equal to M into G. And if I want to calculate the specific weight, what I can do is I can take this equation, and in place of M, I can put rho into V into G. Okay, so rho G will be the specific weight. So weight per unit volume will be specific weight. Okay, so you can find out its value, 7000 Newton per meter cube. All right, and density is also quite easy to calculate, because specific weight, this value is given by rho into G. So dividing this value of small w by G, you will get the value of the density, which comes out to be 713.5 kgs per meter cube. Specific gravity capital S will be equal to the density of the liquid divided by the density of the water. So 713.5 divided by 1000. Okay, so the value of the specific gravity is 0.7135. It means the fluid is less heavier in comparison to water, because if you want to calculate the specific gravity of the water, then it is the density of the water divided by density of the water. So the value will come out to be 1. So then specific gravity of the water will be equal to 1. So I hope this numerical problem is clear. Let us proceed to one more numerical problem. Calculate density, then specific weight and weight W of 1 liter of petrol of specific gravity S is equal to 0.7. Okay, so let us see it here. So specific gravity is given as 0.7 here, and density and specific weight and W is to be calculated, and the volume is given to as 1 liter, so it will be 10 raised to power minus 3 meter cubes. Okay, so specific weight, so from specific gravity we can see the density of the liquid divided by the density of the water. Okay, so density of liquid will be equal to specific weight is given as specific gravity is given as 0.7, and the density of the water is 1000. So it gives us 700 kgs per meter cube. Specific weight, if you want to calculate, that is the density of the liquid multiplied by G. So it will be equal to 700 into 9.81, this much Newton meter cube. And then we have to calculate the value of the weight. So weight is equal to M into G. So M is given by rho into V into G, and rho G is weight, specific weight into volume, and the specific weight value is this value. So you can put it here, 700 into 9.81 into 10 raised to power minus 3, that is the value of the volume. So this will come out to be this value, 6.8679 newtons. Okay, so I hope this part is clear to you. Now let us talk about the viscosity. You have heard about the viscosity. What is viscosity? Viscosity is a property of fluid which offers resistance to the movement of one layer of fluid over another adjacent layer of fluid. And so basically it's a sort of frictional resistance which is offered when two layers are moving over one another, but they have different velocities. Okay, so that is what is shown here. We have a solid surface here, okay, and there is a fluid which is flowing over it. What happens? The layer which comes in contact with this surface has zero velocity. So we assume that this is zero velocity, and sometimes we call it as the no slip condition. It is known as the no slip condition. So no slip condition means velocity which sticks to the solid surface as zero velocity. And you can see this velocity u is in the x direction, this is the x direction, and this is the y direction. So in y direction you will see, as the fluid is moving away and away from the solid surface, its velocity keeps on increasing. So a sort of velocity profile develops. So this is a velocity profile. Okay, at some distance, let us say up at this particular height, perpendicular to this surface, okay, at this particular height, perpendicular to this surface, here you are getting the same velocity with which the fluid was approaching this plate. Okay, so the velocity here is u. So you can see, or you can call it as u infinity. You can call it here also as u infinity. So here the value of the velocity is zero, and slowly following this type of variation, at this particular point, once again, the velocity is u infinity. So I can say there are number of layers. The first layer, which is shown here, it has the zero velocity. Then I take this particular layer. Here the velocity is, say, u, which is once again less than u infinity, and so on. Okay. So I am considering any two layers, one which is here, and another it is here. So here the value of velocity is u, and here the value of velocity is u plus du. And the distance is dy between these two layers of the fluid, actually. Okay. So let us see it now. What is to be said here? When two layers of the fluid at distance dy apart move one over another at different velocities, say u and u plus du, the viscosity together with the relative velocity causes a shear stress acting between the fluid layers. So there is a shear stress which comes into picture, and this shear stress is basically sort of frictional resistance. It is causing a frictional resistance because the lower layer is moving with the lesser velocity, whereas the upper layer is moving with the larger velocity. Okay, so that is why there is a sort of shear. Okay, there is something known as shear force also. I know that in 11th class there is a chapter on shear stress, normal stresses, and you know, when we apply a force on a particular surface tangential to it, then it is known as the shear force, and the stress produced because of that is the shear stress, actually. Okay, so here also the same thing is happening because the top layer is moving with a larger velocity in comparison to the lower layer. So there is a sort of shear stress which is acting on the lower layer, which is moving with the velocity u. So top layer causes a shear stress on the adjacent lower layer, while the lower layer causes a shear stress on the adjacent top layer. Now the top layer is moving fast, lower layer is moving slow, so it is also causing a sort of shear stress on the upper layer because it is trying to drag it backwards, actually. This shear stress is proportional to the rate of change of velocity with respect to y, and it is denoted by a symbol known as tau. So mathematically we say that tau is proportional to du by dy, okay, because this is the velocity gradient between the two layers, du by dy. So when we replace this constant of proportionality, then we put tau is equal to mu du by dy, where this mu is known as the viscosity. So mu stands for viscosity. This is called as viscosity. Sometimes we call it as coefficient of viscosity. Sometimes we call it as absolute viscosity. And sometimes we also call it as dynamic viscosity. Okay. So there are four names for viscosity. Okay. So once again, tau is equal to mu du by dy. Mu is called the constant of proportionality, known as the coefficient of dynamic viscosity or viscosity. And du by dy represents rate of shear strain or rate of shear deformation or velocity gradient. So it has three names. And from here, we can say mu is equal to tau du by dy. So tau is a stress, and you know that stress is force per unit area. So it has the units of Newton per meter square, and in denominator it's velocity here. So the units are meter per second, whereas y it has the units of meter. So meter and meter cancels out. So we will get the units as Newton meter square second. So mu has the units of Pascal seconds. So dynamic viscosity has the units Pascal seconds, also known as Newton per meter square second, or we can write it as, like, for Newton it is kg meter per second square, this is the value of Newton. Then second, then here we have meter square, and it comes out to be kg meter second. Okay, so this is the this is nothing but Pascal second. Okay, so if I want to write the CGS unit of viscosity, then I have to take all these values in CGS. So the unit in of viscosity in centimeter gram second system will be equal to grams per centimeter minus second, and this unit is actually known as voice. Now if I want to convert this voice into say Pascal second, so what is the relationship between the two actually? Okay, so to convert gram into kilogram, I will have to divide by 1000. Okay, and to convert centimeter into meter, I will have to divide by 1000. And second, we don't have to change it. So finally, you can see it here that 1 poise. Okay, 1 poise is equal to 0.1 Pascal second, or otherwise I can say 10 poise is equal to 1 Pascal second. So I have told you the two units. CGS unit is important because Pascal second is a bigger unit, so sometimes we may be using poise also. So this is the conversion factor. Now kinematic viscosity, it is the ratio of dynamic viscosity to the density. So kinematic viscosity is given by rho, and this is known as nu. Okay, so nu is equal to mu divided by rho. And once again, kinematic viscosity, you know, the unit is kg meter second, density is kgs per meter cube. You can see it, kg and kg cancels out, and here you will be left with meter square per second. So meter square per second is the unit of the kinematic viscosity. And if you take once again this value in centimeter square per second, then it will be known as Stoke. So Stoke, so this is 1 centimeter per second is Stoke. This is the smaller unit of kinematic viscosity. And if you want to convert 1 stoke into meter square per second, then 1 stoke will be equal to 10 raised to power minus 4 meter square per second. Yeah, and centistoke means you means have a even smaller value. So divide stroke by means, or you can say 100 centistoke will be equal to 1 stroke. Okay, so that is how you can get the relationship between the various units. Now Newton's law of viscosity, I think we have already discussed about it. This law, which I just explained you, that tau is equal to mu du by dy, this is also known as Newton's law of viscosity. Newton's law of viscosity. Okay. Yeah. So once again, I will read it for you. It states that shear stress on a fluid element layer is directly proportional to the rate of shear strain, or rate of shear deformation, or velocity gradient. Okay. Rate of shear strain, as you know, is known as rate of deformation. Okay. Also called as velocity gradient. Okay. So I can say that tau is equal to mu du by dy, where this tau is nothing but shear stress. Okay. So shear stress is equal to mu du by dy. And this is very important information. Fluids which obey above relation or Newton's law of viscosity rather, I would say above relation means Newton's law of viscosity are known as Newtonian fluids, and the fluids which do not obey the above relationships are called non-Newtonian fluids. And if we talk about the Newtonian fluids, for example, water or air or say kerosene, okay, so these are Newtonian fluids because they follow this particular Newton's law of viscosity. And all other fluids, for example, if you say blood, say you it means toothpaste, okay, toothpaste is a sort of semi-fluid. So these are non-Newtonian fluids. You can think of some other fluids also. So most of the fluids fall in different types of the categories, okay, and there are very less fluids which may be Newtonian fluids. That means they follow the Newton's law of viscosity. And moreover, now let us talk about the various types of the fluids. Actually, the various types of the fluids are: number one is the ideal fluid. Ideal fluid is one for which the density is constant and there is no viscosity, so viscosity is zero in this particular case. A real fluid is one which is having a particular density and its viscosity has a particular value, okay, means has certain value. So basically all fluids fall under these two categories, rather I would say under the category of number two, real fluid. So all fluids in nature are real fluids because they have particular density and they have particular dynamic viscosity or viscosity. So further we can divide this number two into Newtonian fluid, non-Newtonian fluid and ideal plastic fluid. Okay, so what is a, once again I will be reading it from here, ideal fluid, a fluid which is incompressible, means density is constant, so then density is not varying actually, and is having no viscosity, is known as ideal fluid. Ideal fluid is only an imaginary fluid, as all the fluids which exist have some viscosity. What is a real fluid? A fluid which possesses viscosity is known as a real fluid. All the fluids in actual practice are real fluids. Non-Newtonian fluid, a real fluid in which the shear stress is directly proportional to the rate of shear strain or velocity gradient is known as Newtonian fluid. We discussed about it earlier also. A non-Newtonian fluid, a real fluid in which the shear stress is not proportional to the rate of shear strain or velocity gradient is known as a non-Newtonian fluid. Ideal plastic, a fluid in which shear stress is more than the yield value and shear stress is proportional to the rate of shear strain or velocity gradient is known as ideal plastic fluid. So this is the ideal plastic. Why we are saying that more than the yield values? Because there is a particular value of the shear stress before which it starts showing the variation in the velocity gradient. So means we require a particular value of the shear stress, only then the layers will start flowing over one another, okay, or the velocity gradient will appear. And this is the Newtonian fluid, this is non-Newtonian. You can also show a non-Newtonian fluid by this type of the graph. So basically this ideal plastic fluid is also a non-Newtonian fluid only, okay. So these are the some types of the fluids. It's not a exhaustive list of the types of the fluids, but giving you some idea about it. So this was the first chapter of the fluid mechanics, and now I will move to the second chapter. It is about the pressure, okay. It is pressure and its measurement. So when we talk about the pressure we also talked in basic mechanical engineering. You know that the pressure is given by force per unit area, rather this is the normal component of the force per unit area. And you know, I can write force, this is normal component of force, okay, normal component of force per unit area. If I want to calculate the force, that would be equal to pressure into area. This unit you should not refer to kgf per centimeter square or meter square, this is MKS. Rather, you should remember Newton per meter square. What is Newton per meter square? It is Pascal. And this is SI unit. This also you should not, means you don't require it, Newton per millimeter square. So Pascal is Newton per meter square. Other commonly used units of pressure are kilopascal. You know it is 1000 Newton per meter square. bar is 10 raised to power 5 newton per meter square or 100 kilopascal. This you already know. Now Pascal's law, this also you have studied. It states that the pressure or intensity of pressure, so here we also call the pressure as intensity of the pressure at a point in a static fluid, okay, so static means stationary fluid, is equal in all directions. So if I say this is a container, so if this is a particular look point where I am focusing, so the pressure here in this direction, in this direction, in this direction, they all are equal actually, okay. Or if I take any elemental area like shown here in the triangular element form, so if I say that Px is the pressure which is acting in the x direction, Py is the pressure which is acting in the z y direction, and this is the Pz which is acting in the z direction, okay. So finally what you will see that when we calculate, when we do the analysis, we will find that Px is equal to Py is equal to Pz. So all pressures are equal at a particular point, okay. When we reduce this triangular to a point, actually you will find that this comes out the final answer, that pressure or the pressure intensity at a point in a static fluid is equal in all directions, okay. So I think it should be in the outward direction, you can check it, all these are. Then this is about the pressure variation in a fluid at rest, okay. So once again we are talking about the stationary fluid, and I told you when we calculated the value of the atmospheric pressure, I said that P is given by rho g h, okay. So that that actually is known as hydrostatic law. The pressure at any point in a fluid at rest is obtained by the hydrostatic law, which states that the rate of increase of pressure in the vertically downward direction must be equal to the specific weight of the fluid at that particular point, okay. So basically it means that del P by del Z, so what I am saying Z is the downward direction Z, okay. Here I am not considering it as the Y direction, it is Z direction, or and that should be equal to W, and this W is nothing but specific weight, okay. And if I want to calculate the pressure from this particular point where the value of Z is equal to zero to some other point, let us say which is at a distance Z from the free liquid surface, this is free surface of the fluid or liquid, so what I can do is I can say that dp is equal to, now this W is equal to rho g dz. I can integrate it between from z is equal to 0 to z is equal to z, okay. So if you will integrate the left hand side, you will say that it is pressure at, now if I call this point as A, okay, this is A, or say surface AB, okay. So I can say the pressure at point A minus pressure at the top where the Z is equal to zero. So I am, because I am concerned about the pressure due to fluid only, so the pressure at the top surface will be zero actually, okay. So it is zero at Z is equal to zero, okay. So here the pressure is zero, that is equal to rho g z minus zero. So effectively the pressure at point A comes out to be rho g z, where z is the depth of the surface from the free surface of the fluid, and this is only giving me the value of the gauge pressure. This is giving me only the value of the gauge pressure. I discussed about in basic mechanical engineering course also. So if I am really interested in calculating the total pressure at the surface AB, means if I want the total pressure at this particular point, then PA absolute, okay, will be equal to PA गेज प्लस पी एटमॉस्फेरिक, ओके, सो दैट इज़ द वैल्यू एक्चुअली, और आई कैन से दिस इज इक्वल टू, वंस अगेन आई एम जस्ट चेंजिंग द कलर, सी प्रेशर ए एब्सोल्यूट इज इक्वल टू पी एटमॉस्फेरिक प्लस पी ए गेज, सो इट बिकम्स पी एटमॉस्फेरिक प्लस पी ए गेज विल बी रो जी जेड, सो दैट इज द वैल्यू, ओके. सो दिस इज इजी टू अंडरस्टैंड, एंड इफ आई हैव टू कैलकुलेट व्हाट इज द प्रेशर हेयर ऑन द फ्री सरफेस ऑफ द लिक्विड, सो आई नो दिस इज द एटमॉस्फेरिक प्रेशर विच इज एक्टिंग हेयर, ओके. सो इफ आई कॉल दिस सरफेस एज से एक्स, ओके, देन एट एक्स द वैल्यू ऑफ पी गेज इज इक्वल टू जीरो बिकॉज इट इज ऑन द सरफेस ऑफ द लिक्विड एक्चुअली, सो द गेज प्रेशर इज जीरो हेयर, एंड इफ आई कैलकुलेट द एब्सोल्यूट प्रेशर एट एक्स, सो पी एब्सोल्यूट एट एक्स विल बी इक्वल टू पी गेज एट एक्स प्लस पी एटमोस्फेरिक, एंड एज आई सेड दैट पी गेज एट एक्स इज जीरो, सो पी एब्सोल्यूट एट एक्स इज इक्वल टू पी एटमोस्फेरिक ओनली, ओके. आई होप दिस इज क्लियर टू यू, एंड दिस इज द डेरिवेशन विच इज शोन हेयर, सो दैट इज नॉट रिक्वायर्ड फॉर यू टू डू, सो यू कैन सी इट हेयर, दिस इज द हाइड्रोस्टेटिक लॉ, वट डज इट सेज दैट, या दिस वन, डेल पी बाय डेल जेड इज इक्वल टू स्पेसिफिक वेट रो इन टू जी, डब्ल्यू इज द वेट डेंसिटी ऑफ द फ्लूइड, एंड इक्वेशन दिस 2.4 स्टेट्स दैट रेट ऑफ इंक्रीज ऑफ प्रेशर इन द वर्टिकल डायरेक्शन इज इक्वल टू वेट डेंसिटी ऑफ द फ्लूइड एट दैट पर्टिकुलर पॉइंट, एंड दिस इज नोन एज द हाइड्रोस्टेटिक लॉ, दिस आई हैव ऑलरेडी एक्सप्लेन्ड यू, सो यू कैन सी P is the pressure above the atmospheric pressure. Okay, this equation, when I am getting the value of the pressure, this is the pressure above the atmospheric pressure. So it means it is the gauge pressure only. And Z is the height of the point from the free surface. Okay, height means this is something that it is below actually, not the height. Okay, so Z, yeah, sometimes if I want to convert the pressure into height, then I can also use this particular equation. For example, suppose I have a container like this, okay, this is the container, and if I say at the bottom the gauge pressure is say 1 bar, okay, I am saying that suppose this bottom I give a name B, okay, so the pressure B, and you know I am telling you about this, this is the gauge value actually, gauge pressure actually, okay, so I want that to know what is the height of this column, okay, height of this column which is basically Z actually, this is the free surface, okay, this is the free surface of the liquid and its height is Z, and the pressure at the bottom of this container is 1 bar, so I can easily use this particular equation. So Z will be equal to P divided by rho G in, and if I say it is water, okay, then 1 bar is equal to 10 raised to the power 5 Newton per meter square divided by density of the water is 1000 kg per meter cube multiplied by 9.81, which is the value of G, and you can calculate this value comes out to be 10.33 meters. So basically, when we talk about the atmospheric pressure, when we talk about the atmospheric pressure, we say that 760 millimeter of mercury column is equal to 1 atmosphere, okay, so it is in the terms of mercury column. If I had to tell this particular value of the atmospheric pressure, which is 1 atmosphere, then I can say that it is equal to 10.33 meter of water column. So it means if I take two pipes like this, okay, this is one of the pipes in which I am keeping the mercury here, and it's the level of the mercury in this pipe is 0.76 meters, and I take another pipe here and I fill it up to a height of say 10.33 meter of water column. So this is water. Okay, so if I take this surface, I call this as B in this water pipe, and I call here it also as B. Then the pressure here and the pressure here is atmospheric pressure, means it is 1 bar pressure. Okay, but if you want to calculate the total pressure here at point number B in both the cases, it will be equal to 2 atmospheres. Okay, because I am just talking about the gauge pressure, but there is atmospheric pressure which is also acting here. Okay, this is P atmospheric in both the cases. So effectively, if I want to represent 1 atmospheric pressure, which is the means usual definition of the atmospheric pressure, then either I should say 76 centimeter or 760 millimeter of mercury column, or 0.76 meter of mercury column, and the equivalent column of water for that would be 10.33 meter. Okay, that is why you must know that when we are using barometer, you know, you might have heard about the name of the barometer. Actually, barometer is a device used for the measurement of the atmospheric pressure. Okay, in this device we never use water for measurement of the pressure. The reason is very clear. If you want to measure the atmospheric pressure, then in that particular case you should have a pipe of height which is around 11 or 12 meters. So how will you measure that pressure? It's very difficult. That is why we go for mercury as the working fluid, because in that particular case the height is only 76 centimeter, which you can manage easily, and you can see the values of the atmospheric pressure in that particular case also. Okay, and now this particular topic which is there in this slide, you can see it's absolute pressure, gauge pressure, atmospheric pressure and vacuum pressure. This I have already discussed in basic mechanical engineering course. This diagram also I discussed there. So you all know all these values. Absolute pressure is equal to atmospheric plus gauge pressure. Vacuum pressure is atmospheric pressure minus absolute pressure. Okay, and this atmospheric pressure at sea level is this much, this much, this, these things, this is not required actually. Okay, 760 millimeter or 10.33 meter of column of water. Okay, this I have discussed. Now I am going to the measurement of the pressure. Now when we have to measure the pressure, we need certain devices. One is the manometers, other is the mechanical gauges. Mechanical gauges, whenever you are going to some petrol pump and you get the air filled into the tires, the person who is filling the air, he has a mechanical gauge in his hand. He can see it there, what is the pressure he is filling. And you tell him that in the tire you fill the tire the pressure as 30 psi or 35 psi. You actually don't say psi, you just say bhaiya isko jo hai 35 kar do isme pressure, ya isme 25 kar do pressure. To wo jo 25 ya 35 hai, wo that is actually psi, pounds per square inch, pounds per square inch. To wo jo value hai wo fps system of units mein hai. Okay, there we are not saying ki isme jo pressure hai that you fill in bars actually, because that bar value will be very small. Okay, and if you want to convert that, you may not be knowing something 14 point some up to some decimal places, that is actually equivalent to 1 bar. So actually if I will write it here, 14 point something something is equal to 1 bar. Okay, and if you are going for 30 psi, that would be about 2 bar. Okay, so those are the mechanical gauges. And manometers, what is the use of manometers? Manometers are defined as the devices used for measuring the pressure at a point in a fluid by balancing the column of the fluid by same or another column of the fluid. Okay, so I will explain you about it. They are classified as either simple manometers or differential manometers. Okay, mechanical gauges, I have already told you, these are diaphragm pressure gauge, Bowden tube pressure gauge, bellows pressure gauge, dead weight pressure gauge. So you just have to what you say is need to know about the name. Not much is required that you know about their construction details. That is not required at all. Now, let us talk about the simple manometer. Like in which, what is a simple manometer? Which is used for the measurement of the pressure of a at a point in a fluid by balancing the column of the fluid by same on another column of the fluid. So let us try to see what is a simple manometer. The first one is the piezometer. Okay. So piezometer. Now let us suppose we have a pipe like this. Okay, and let us say some fluid is flowing through this pipe. Like I can say that it could be your water pipeline in your home, which is in which the water is flowing under pressure. So I say that the gauge pressure is say 1.1 bar. Okay, 1.1 bar. Or rather, I will say, even if I will take a smaller value, 1.1 is quite big. I will say that, just a minute. So the gauge pressure is say 0.05 bar. Okay. Yeah. And it's water. Okay. So it is flowing through the pipe. Now I want to know. I had already given you the value, but how to measure that this is the pressure actually? So what I will do, I will put a pipe here. Okay, just a simple pipeline, just a simple pipe. I will connect it here. Now what will happen? What is the pressure which is acting here? It is atmospheric pressure. But the pressure of the fluid inside is, pressure here is actually higher because it's the positive gauge pressure. So the total pressure which of the water which is flowing here is, it is P atmospheric plus 0.05. this much bar. So what will happen? The water will rise up here. Say it rises up to this particular level, this H. So this H is now representing the head, which is equivalent to this gauge pressure actually. It is, this H is actually representing 0.05 bar. So how to calculate this value of H? Because water is flowing, I said from the hydrostatic law, we said that Z is given by the formula is P is equal to rho G Z. So Z is equal to P by rho G. So here I am saying this Z is H actually. So this will be equal to pressure, which is equal to 0.05. into, I can say, 10 raised to the power 5 newton per meter square, okay, divided by rho, density of the water is 1000 multiplied by 9.81, and then you can find out what is the value. I think it will come somewhere around 50 centimeter. Okay, so that is how you can calculate the value of the pressure of water. Means this piezometer tube will always be used for measurement of the very small pressures. It cannot measure very high pressures actually, because in case of high water pressure, like I told you initially, I was considering it as the 1.1 bar. So 1.1 bar means I would require a pipe height of around 11 to 12 meters. So that is not possible. So it is used for the measurement of the very low pressures. The second one is the U-tube manometers. So yeah, piezometer is here, the first one. Okay, U-tube manometer. This piezometer I have already explained you. It is once again shown here. Okay, so don't worry about that. Now I am coming to the U-tube manometer. So U-tube manometer, yeah, it is used for the measurement of the higher pressures. Okay, it consists of a glass tube bent in U shape, one end of which is connected to a point where the pressure is to be measured, and other end remains open to the atmosphere as shown in diagram. So this end is open, and this is the U type of tube and it is connected to at a particular location, and this is the pipeline. So this is a pipeline here, okay, through which some fluid is flowing. So I like this or like the other way, and we want to know what is the pressure at this particular location. So what we do, we have connected this U tube here, and what will happen, the pressure here is the gauge pressure here is, let us say, 2 bar, for example. Now, you know, because it's 2 bar, so I can't take water as the liquid in this U-tube manometer. Okay, I can't take it. So what I will do, I have taken a fluid which is actually mercury. Okay, it won't be so high pressure here also, because 2 bar will require a height of mercury column which is actually somewhere 152 centimeter. So let us say here also, if it is say 0.5 bar or like that, okay, so smaller length, because you know, have not been to the university. Had you been to the university, I could have shown you the YouTube manometers also. So they are of normal height, maybe your dining table or a little bit more higher, actually maybe around you can say 2 meters, not more than that. Sometimes that can go, okay, 2 meters, so 200 centimeters, that can also happen actually, okay. So what will happen when this pressure acts here? So initially what is happening, actually, suppose this pipe is not there. Now I am considering that there is atmospheric pressure initially, okay. So there you have a U-tube manometer connected like this, and this is the mercury level in both sides, okay. So this level will be same at the same position. Now suppose this atmospheric, instead of atmospheric pressure, now there is some fluid which is flowing through it, and its pressure is P gauge, which is equal to 1 bar, like I told you. So what will happen, this, there are two limbs of this U-tube manometer. This is the left limb and this is the right limb, okay, limb. So I can say that this side there is a drop in you can say mercury level, and here it will rise to, up to this particular point. So effectively this will be the rise, the difference in two levels. In the left limb, this is the level of the mercury, from here below there is mercury, and it goes up to this particular point. So the difference in the levels of mercury in two limbs is actually given as H. So what I can do is, now the pressure at this particular point, where both in both the limbs, the here the mercury level is starting, and here up to this particular point, this is the right limb. So at this particular location, I call this as XX. So X in the left limb or X in the right limb, the pressure is same at both the places. So I can calculate the pressure of the fluid which is here. If I say the pressure of the fluid, I denoted by PF, which is the pressure at this particular location, and this is acting here, okay. So I will say PF, pressure at this particular point, then there is a drop in pressure here by, let us say, this is H1 and this is say H2, okay, plus rho of the fluid multiplied by G into H of this fluid, which is basically H1, okay. This is the pressure at X point here, okay. I am saying that here X, and here you have the X. So here it is H1, and in the right hand side the pressure is rho for the mercury into G into the height difference in level is H2. So basically pressure of the fluid in the pipeline will be equal to rho for the mercury into G into H2 minus, here we have rho of the fluid into G into H1. So that is how we can calculate the value of the pressure of a fluid which is having a higher pressure than the atmospheric. And similarly, we can also calculate the vacuum pressure here. So vacuum pressure, you can give a try to it. Right now it's already 2. So I will leave you. So just see this lecture once again. So any questions, if you want to ask, you can ask me. Otherwise, in the next lecture.